Seems like time is running pretty fast. The week started, and before you know it, the week is almost ended. We just have one more day tomorrow, and this week is gone. Time does not shout, it just has a way of running out. Is that true? Yeah. There's a man who was walking, kind of strolling, and he came across a gallery store with paintings in its windows. And what caught his attention was a particular painting that was right in the center of it. And here it is. As he stared at the picture, childhood memories began to creep up in his mind. It was a long time since he had been to church. Long time that he had thought about anything like this. And as he stood there gazing, all of a sudden he felt like there was somebody next to him. And it's a little boy. The little boy had walked up next to him, and the little boy began to point out people in the picture. And he said, "Mister, you see the one kneeling down by the cross? Well, that's Mary Magdalene. And do you see the woman next to a young man there? That's Mary, the mother of Jesus. And that's John." And as he is naming different people in the scene, the man began to feel a lump in his throat. And he just couldn't handle it anymore, so he just quietly walked away. And as he's walking down the block, all of a sudden he feels a tug on his back coat. And the man turned around, it's a little boy. And the little boy said, "Mister, I forgot to tell you that the middle one was Jesus, and he died for you." Yes, Jesus, and he died for you. Let's pray together as we study his word. Loving God, we thank you that we can open your holy word, and we pray that your spirit will guide and direct us. For Jesus' sake we ask it. Amen. Tonight's topic is called Battle for the Mind. And it's a continuation of that which we've been studying so far. But in this particular topic, we look at Revelation chapter 7, verse 1 through 3. You remember that we studied the seven seals of Revelation, and we went through chapter 4, chapter 5, we did chapter 6, and then we stopped at chapter 6. Because from chapter 6, the last verse, there's something in the middle. And that's chapter 7 before you go to chapter 8. And chapter 8 begins with the verse, "And there was silence in heaven." And some people wonder why it is that you have chapter 6, the last seal, the sixth seal, should I say, is in chapter 6. And all of a sudden, there's this chapter 7 that apparently has nothing to do with the seals. And then the next seal, the seventh seal, is in chapter 8, verse 1. The question is why? Why is it like that? It's because the chapter 7 is an answer to the last question of chapter 6. And if you remember the last question of chapter 6, as the people who are ill-prepared see Jesus returning, it says that they begin to cry to the rocks and to the mountains and say, "Fall on us and hide us." I'm reading verse 16, by the way, chapter 6. "And hide us from the face of him that sitteth on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb. For the great day of his wrath is come." And then the question, "And who shall be able to stand?" In chapter 7, it's the answer to chapter 6's question. Who will be able to stand? But chapter 7 opens up with some angels. And the Bible says there that the angels who are standing in the four quarters of the earth, it says that they're standing and they're holding the four winds of the earth, that the wind should not blow on the earth, nor on the sea, nor on any tree. In other words, it introduces us into a time of judgment. And what? Time of judgment. Because since the question is raised, then there has to be an answer. But in order to give an answer, there has to be a process by which this answer can be satisfied. And so it says that there are four angels that are holding, and right now they're straining to hold back the winds that are about to blow on this earth. But before the winds are permitted to blow on this earth, even though we're seeing an increase of calamities, we're seeing an increase of things happening that are troubling people all over the world, yet we haven't seen the worst of it. Not long ago, I had to go to the Philippines with a team of 21 doctors because what you call a super typhoon had hit the Philippines, a little town called Tacloban. And when we went to that town looked like some atomic bomb had completely razed the town, the city. That city was completely demolished. And in every place, there were bodies. And we went there to help those who survived the storm by either doing surgery and delivering babies, healing wounds, etc. It's a terrible devastation. Now they're experiencing what is called super typhoons. Super typhoons never existed before. We used to call them typhoons. Super hurricanes never existed before. They used to be called hurricanes. So the angels are holding back. But why is it they're holding back? Notice what it says. And I saw another angel ascending from the east, having the seal of the living God. And he cried with a loud voice to the four angels to do what? It says, to these who were given the power to hold back from hurting the earth and the sea, and it says, hurt not the earth, neither the sea, nor the trees, until when? Till we have sealed the servants of our God in their foreheads. So there's a process of selection, a process of qualifying, as it were, the ones that shall escape the terrible tribulation. When I was on the plane, a man asked me the question, what do you know about the tribulation? I said, you're asking the wrong person. He said, why? I said, because I wrote a book about it. So I'm going to have the tendency to be biased. Well, he said, tell me what you wrote. So I began to explain to him. And so it says then, hurt not the earth, neither the sea, neither the trees, till we have sealed the servants of our God in their foreheads. Now it's interesting because here there's a process of selection, pre-selection. Sometimes you get in your mail an envelope that says open up, it's important. And then they tell you, you have been pre-selected. How many of you have received one of those envelopes? You have been what? Pre-selected. They make you feel like you have been selected, but the reality is when you open the letter, you find out that you have not been selected at all. That you have to fill this out and send it in before you can be selected, okay? So this is a pre-selection that takes place prior to the experience that those people have when they see Christ that has come. Because those people recognize that they do not qualify. And so they're asking the question, who will be able to stand? Now, I want you to notice that in Revelation 13, there's another pre-selection. It's interesting. that you had Revelation chapter 7, which is a parenthesis between 6 and 8, and you have Revelation chapter 14, which is in between 13 and 15. And 15 and 16 have to do with the wrath of God. And so prior to the wrath of God, there's a pre-selection again mentioned in Revelation chapter 14. And it gives you some qualifying language that helps you to know why they have been selected. All right? You can read it in Revelation chapter 14. So here then in chapter 13, it's another, as it were, pre-selection. But in this particular case, it says, he causeth all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark in their what? Right hand or in their foreheads, and that no man might buy or sell, save he that had the mark or the name of the beast or the number of his name. Now, what's interesting is this. The first pre-selection is only where? In the forehead. The other one is where? In the hand or in the forehead. In other words, the first one is particular, the other one is not. Now, there is a difference between sealing and marking. Is there? Let me explain to you what I mean. How many of you know what this is? Any of you know what this is? Now, if I was to show this in New York City, they wouldn't know what it is. Okay? That's where I grew up. You show me something like that, what is that? But people out here do something called canning. What do? How many of you have done canning? Any of you? All right. And those of you who have not done canning, you need to get on the stick, as they say back in New York City. All right? In other words, here, these jars are in, as it were, a tub or a pan, a big, big, big pot. And they're in there for a purpose. When I was, when we had children at home, and we had the time in our hands, we would do something called canning. That is, that we would go and buy bushels of apples and bushels of peaches and so forth, and we'd take them home, and we began the process of getting those peaches and apples to be prepared to be preserved. To be what? Preserved. And what we would do is the apples, we would have to peel the skin off, and we would have to core them, take out the core, and then you take what's left over and you put them in a pot and you bring them to a boil. And then you take the jars without the lids and you put that pulp that has boiled down into those jars. And then you take the lid and you don't tighten the lid, you put the lid on and you put those jars in the water. And you heat up the jars along with the applesauce that you have in there or the peaches or whatever. We used to love apricot, boy. When we would make apricot, and we had apricot for the rest of the winter months, and we would get what is called zwieback. Now, I don't know if I'm talking the right language to some of you folks. You know what zwieback is? It's bread that you dry up. What is it? Yeah, kind of you dry up the bread. You took the whole wheat bread, you put it in the oven, you let it dry up, and that's zwieback, and that lasts longer than the normal bread. It doesn't mold as fast. So then, anyway, it was time to put the apricot on the zwieback, and boom, 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 boom. Am I causing any mouths to water here? All right. So then once the jars get heated up, then you take out the jars, you set them aside, and you let them cool off, but before they cool off, you then tighten the lid. And the purpose of that is that once you tighten the lid and the jar cools off, it creates a vacuum. A what? A vacuum, and that seals it. That what? Now you have applesauce that you can keep on the shelf through the winter time, and anytime you want applesauce, you just pop the lid and scrumptious. We used to love Golden Delicious applesauce. Any of you like Golden Delicious? All right. Now, so that was a process of preserving the fruit so that we can have fruit throughout the winter time. Now, question. When we were cutting the fruit, what would remain in the jar and what would be left out? I think you would agree that you would leave the bad parts out, correct? So you cut out the bad parts and you only put inside the jar the what? The good. You don't take the good and throw it away and put the bad stuff to preserve it. You want to preserve only the good. Only the what? The good. And so then once you cut off the bad and you put the good in the jar, then you want to seal only the good. And so what that is telling us is that God is using a language that should help us understand that what he wants to do is he wants to get rid of the bad in us so that he can preserve only the good. But is there anything good in us of ourselves? No. The only good that you can have that can be preserved is the goodness of Christ in you. The what? Goodness of Christ in you. And so that's what is called sealing. However, the other one is called marking. So you go to a grocery store and something is post-dated. It is what? Post-dated. What does that mean? It means it has gone beyond the date that it should be on the shelf. So what do? They mark it. They what? They mark it. Okay. So what's the difference between the marked one and the one that's sealed? The marked one is going bad, while the ones that are sealed are good. All right. So the Bible is revealing something interesting to us. God, before Jesus comes, he has to do a process of qualifying. And in order to do that process of qualifying, he must set a seal. A what? A seal. And that seal is to preserve finally whatever God has permitted to put in you that he can seal for eternity. You got that? The mark of the beast can be placed on you, and it doesn't mean that you're good. It just means that you're marked. So right now we can recognize that we do not want to be marked. We want to be sealed, all right? But if you notice that the primary place where the seal is to take place is where? In the forehead. So why does God mention the forehead? Okay, in the Bible, seals were placed on scrolls, like right here. You have some wax seals that are being placed on a scroll. And the seal was to keep inside what was placed inside, all right? Therefore, the Bible says, let this mind be in you, which was where? Also in whom? In Christ Jesus. There is a battle for the mind then. Since the enemy wants to mark the forehead and God wants to seal the forehead, it means then that the main battle for you and for me is not in our hands, it's not in our feet, it's in where? It's on our minds, all right? Now, why the forehead? Why the mind? The forehead is the seat of reason. It is the what? It is the seat of reason. In there is where you have what is called judgment, reason, conscience, intellect, the will, moral discernment, and spirituality. And since that's where characters develop, that's where the real battle is in. It's where? It's in your forehead. Or better yet, in your frontal lobe. That's where you develop character. Now, we're told that a person's character is formed between the ages of 5 and 7. Did you know that? A person's character is formed between the ages of 5 and 7. That's why there's some adages that are go like this. The difference between a man and a boy is the price of their toy. Have you heard that before? There's another one that says, men grow tall, but their hearts do not change after all. So basically, by the time you're 7, you are what you're going to be the rest of your life in character, unless there's a change. And Harvard University did a little research to discover when a character would be formed in a person. And they concluded from the age of 5 to 7 is when the character is established. Then they asked the question, Can character be changed? Can you alter character? And they concluded that characters can be altered. And it's interesting, this is what they said. They discovered that a person's character can be altered by one of three things. Number one, a personal traumatic experience that you go through. A what? A personal traumatic experience that you go through. Some near-death experience that you go through. You had a car accident that almost killed you. It may wake you up and make you realize that you need to change the way you are. Somebody holds a gun to your head. It makes you realize that you're pretty close to death. Maybe you ought to get your life in order. You understand what I'm saying? So they said that a personal traumatic experience. The second one was a personal traumatic experience of some loved one, somebody that you love. Your mom, your dad, your brother, your sister, your child gets injured or dies. Some traumatic experience that happens to a loved one can effect a change in character. And I have been to many funerals where young people who have grown up with parents who have been godly parents and who have prayed for their kids, and their kids are still living wild, and their parents die. At that moment, I have seen people come to their senses and decide that they're going to get their life right with God. The last one, which is interesting, they said what can effect a change in character is a genuine, did you hear what I said? A genuine born-again experience. That's interesting, isn't it? A what? A genuine. Why did they say a genuine? Because there are a lot of people who say, I'm born again, and they're still thieves, and they're still crooks, and they still curse, and they still get drunk, and they still do all sorts of things that they used to do before. For example, I had a lady that came to visit me one time. My church member told her that she could come to talk to me. She was from another faith, and that she needed counseling. So she came to me. She was weeping, and I said, what's the matter? She said, I'm concerned about my husband. I said, what about it? Well, she said, he drinks a lot and he runs out with other women. So I said to her, well, I'm concerned about his salvation. She said, oh, I'm not worried about his salvation. I said, you're not? She said, no, he's saved. See? So you can be a drunkard, you can be a womanizer, you can do all those things, but now that you're saved, you're okay, you see? Well, Harvard University recognizes that those things do happen, and so that's why they said a what? A genuine born-again experience. Because they have noticed that people who go through what is called a born-again experience do have a change of character. The characters change. They begin to be different people than they were before. And so the scripture then is dealing with a battle for the mind that effects a character change. A what? A character change. And so the devil then is seeking to gain the homage that belongs to who? To God. But where is that battle being fought? In your mind. Where is it? In your mind. You see, the devil cannot take your hand and make you steal something. The devil cannot take your feet and make you walk into doing something wrong. But he can put thoughts in your mind that can lead you to do that which is wrong. Is that true? Because the acts begin where? In the mind. And so he seeks to get man's homage. He sought to get Christ's homage. But how did he try to do it? Notice what the devil did. Again, the devil taketh him up into an exceeding high mountain and showeth him all the kingdoms of the world. This is the first marketing agent recorded in history. Who is it? The devil. The first what? Marketing agent. Have you noticed that when you watch television and they're trying to entice you to go to a vacation, what is it that they show you? Do they show you all the drug addicts and all the stealing that's going on and all the terrible things? What do they show you? They show you all the beautiful, glorious turquoise water, white sand beaches, smooth moving palm trees, and people always laughing and having a wonderful time, correct? And so the devil then showed Christ all the kingdoms and what else? And their glory. He didn't hide, he hid all the things that were bad. And he only showed what was good. Listen, I've been to too many places in the world. It's supposed to be gorgeous places and all that. And they are gorgeous places. But when you arrive there, you find that there's a lot of wickedness there that they didn't tell you about. A lot of immorality. A lot of things that are bad that they didn't tell you about. And so the devil showed all the glory. And here's what he said. All these things will I what? Will I give thee if thou wilt what? Fall down and what? And worship me. Could the devil force Christ to take those kingdoms? No. So what did he try to do? He tried to entice him by showing the glories of these kingdoms so that Jesus could say, oh, I want them. Well, you're going to have them. You don't have to go to the cross. All you have to do is just simply do what? All you have to do is do one act. Just bow down and worship me. And you can have it all. He hasn't given up that fight since the cross or before. He's still working on the minds. What's he doing? He's working on the minds. So listen. The issue then is, who will you give your allegiance to? There are only two sides. How many? Two sides. There's the right side and there's the wrong side. Who will you give your allegiance to? Well, you may say in your mind, well, I give my allegiance to Christ. But it's more than just saying I give my allegiance to Christ, because that's precisely what's happening with what I just presented to you about people who go around declaring that they're Christians, and at the same time, they are living in a way that's obvious that it doesn't harmonize with the life of Christ. Okay. It was the great leader of India that one time said the whole world would become Christian if it wasn't for the Christian. The whole world would become what? Christian if it wasn't for the Christian. Well, how does the devil seek to gain your allegiance? He does it by one of two ways. One is called the temptation, and what's the other one? By deception. So how does he work on your mind? Since we are living in the day of judgment, we're living in the antitypical day of atonement, we're living in the last days of Earth's history, you should understand that this is a very important issue to consider. How is it that the enemy can gain my allegiance? Because if I'm not with Christ, I am with Satan. There are people who say, look, I'm not for the devil, I'm not for Christ. Well, the problem with that is that there's no such thing as a neutral ground. You're either for one or you're for the other. By default, you're for one or for the other. For example, the people who voted for Trump were against who? Hillary. And they showed that they were against Hillary because they were for Trump. And the people who voted for Hillary, they were against Trump. Okay? So you go for one, and by default, you are against the other. There's no neutral ground. So how does he work? First of all, the Bible says that all of us are tempted. But let's look at it. Let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of who? Of God, for God cannot be tempted with evil. Neither tempteth he, how many? Any man. So whenever you're tempted, is it God? What's the answer? No. But it says, every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own what? Lust and enticed. So there are things in us. It's called propensities. What is it called? Propensity. That's a word that simply means a natural bent to. What does it mean? A natural bent to. We, by nature, have tendencies that cause us to lean a certain way. And if we don't watch it, by nature, we go that way. So propensities. And since we have these natural bents, and the enemy knows that we have these natural bends, then he takes advantage of it by tempting us. Now, I want you to remember this. There is no sin in temptation because Jesus was tempted, right? Did you hear what I said? There is no sin in the temptation. The sin is when you yield to the temptation, when you contemplate it, when you mull over it, when you just go over and over in your mind. So you can be tempted, all right? But here's what happens. Then when lust hath what? Conceived, it bringeth forth sin, and sin, when it is finished, bringeth forth what? Death. And so when a person is tempted, he is tempted because there are already things in his own life that the devil, all he has to do is push the button. You understand what I'm saying? Now, however, we should be remembered that God does not allow you to be tempted beyond what you can handle. Here's the promise. They have no temptation taken you, but such as is what? Is common to man, but God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that you are able. But what will he do? But will with the temptation also do what? Make a way of escape that you may be able to bear it. So the alibi, the devil made me do it, is not true. Did you hear what I said? Some people say, well, I couldn't help it. The devil made me do it. The reality is that, as I said, the devil cannot take your hand and put it on the apple or put it on whatever and make you take it. It is something that you do by exercising your own will, as it being manipulated by somebody else, okay? And so the problem is that a person who doesn't believe that there's a personal devil, that there's a real devil out there, is most vulnerable, because since he doesn't believe that there's a devil, he thinks that all the thoughts that are up here are of his own invention. The reality is that the devil knows your thought patterns because he has put enough thoughts in you to see how you respond. And all he has to do is just throw the ball at you and you run with it. So he places thoughts in your mind with the hope that you will follow the thought and it conceive and become sin. When a person doesn't understand that, his mind is open to whatever suggestion the devil throws at him. But when a person begins to be drawn to God and the person responds to God, his mind becomes more and more sensitive and can then be able to detect when those thoughts are coming and by God's grace can push those thoughts away. So rather than being manipulated, the person who becomes aware that there is a real devil and that there's a choice that needs to be made can detect. Can what? Can detect. And so that's why it says, there have no temptation taken you but such as is what? Common to man. But God will make a what? A way of escape that you may be able to bear it. So it doesn't matter what temptations come to you. What matters is what you can do with that temptation. What do you say? Because all of us are tempted. And the Bible says then that you can cast down what? You can cast down these imaginations and what else? And every high thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of God, and bring it into captivity, every thought to the what? To the obedience of Christ. In other words, the battle is on. Your mind is the game field. You can choose either to be manipulated or you can choose to have God strengthen your mind so that you can do God's will. And the more you allow God to strengthen your mind, the more easy it becomes to do his will. The less you are in contact with God, the less that God is in your life, the more open you up to a superhuman being that has the ability to manipulate your thoughts so that you will do his bidding. So he uses temptation, but he also uses what? Deception. What does he use? Deception. Here's one of the great deceptions. It's called what? Addictions. What is it called? Addictions. I remember when I was a boy in New York City that this the drug selling became very popular. Prior to the drugs, it was alcohol. Those of us who are older can remember when there was a great battle by the government to try to keep people from making alcohol. How many of you remember that? They were called bootleggers. What were they called? Bootleggers. And so they were making alcohol in cellars and every place and selling the alcohol. Well, finally, the government made alcohol legal, and that stopped some of that bootlegging, except that it didn't stop the alcoholism. It just increased it. Now it just became legal. That was all that happened. So then from that, people couldn't make as much money as they could before when they were bootlegging. So now they shifted to something else. They found drugs. And they began to spread the drugs in our neighborhood. I remember drug pushers coming by and saying something like this, "Man, you don't know what living is like until you do this." And I'll tell you why, because I think you're a good kid, I'm just going to give it to you for free so you can have a try. And the kids that fell for it became drug addicts. And all they were doing was hoping they could find people who could become dependent upon the substance to continue to supply them with money. It was not about wanting to make you feel better. It was about wanting to make you a slave to them. And so they created things that are called what? Addictions. And there are all sorts of addictions that today people are dealing with. It's a terrible thing. I can remember as a little boy, we used to live in a row of buildings that were five stories high. And between the top story where we lived and the roof, there was a set of stairs that went up to the rooftop. And most of the time when we wanted to go to the roof, there was usually some drug addicts up there on the landing, completely drugged up, out cold, and usually they were wrecks of life. And I could remember seeing those people and thinking, I don't want to do that. I don't want to be like that. I used to pass around them and go up to the rooftop. But all sorts of addictions. And then one day, I was up on the roof, and a friend of mine came by, and he came with a cigarette. And he began to throw up smoke rings. And then he said, "I bet you can't do that." And I saw that, and I said, "What do you mean I can't do that? Give me that cigarette." And so I took a deep drag, and I discovered I couldn't do that. I coughed and choked and coughed and rolled over, and he laughed and laughed and laughed. You understand? Well, I was 13 years old. How old was I? 13 years old. And in my lack of wisdom, I decided I was going to prove to him that I was just as tough as he was. So I got myself some cigarettes and began to do it a little at a time until one day I was walking down the street, I saw him, and I said, "Look, buddy," and I threw up the smoke rings, you see. But what I didn't realize was that by getting used to it, I became what? Addicted. Now, there are some people who don't understand that when they're addicted, that they are servants of who? Of Satan. But they don't like to admit that. I was talking to a gentleman one day. He wanted to follow the Lord. And I said, "Is there anything that keep you from following the Lord?" He said, "Well, I got a little problem." I said, "What's your problem?" He said, "Well, I smoke." I said, "Well, do you think you can, you know, if you want, I can help you quit." I said, "I've run hundreds of programs to help people quit smoking. I can help you stop." No, it's all right. I can get rid of it. It's just a little problem. Next week I come to visit him. I said, "How's your little problem?" He said, "Well, the Lord knows I love him." What did he say? "The Lord knows I love him." And I said, "No, the Lord knows you don't love him." He said, "What do you mean?" He got offended by that. I said, "I want to show you a text, and here it is. No, notice what it says, Romans 6:16. Know ye not that to whom you what? You yield yourselves servants to what? To obey. His servant you are, to whom you obey. So I asked him, I said, tell me something. Is that cigarette from the Lord? He said, I don't want to think that way. I said, well, my brother, I said, I need to help you understand that you're being deceived and you're playing the role of self-deception. He said, what do you mean? I said, think of it. You don't want to admit that cigarettes does not come from God, because you know that if you say it doesn't come from God, you're going to have to admit that it comes from whom? From the devil. And if you admit it comes from the devil, then you're going to have to admit that you're his servants, according to this verse. And that's what you don't want to do. He said, that's true. I said, you'll never gain the victory over your addiction until you recognize that you are not following the Lord by doing that. You will gain the victory when you admit that you have an addiction and that is not from the Lord, and the only one that can give you the power over it is the Lord. Did you hear what I'm saying? So it is not safe for us to say, well, the Lord knows that I love him, and when he's good and ready, he'll take it away. No, the reality is, friends, that that's a deception. It's a what? A deception. There are many honest people who want to believe in their hearts that they still love God and serve God, even though they are addicted. The reality is, friends, that that instrument that they're hooked to, they love more than God. It's just that they don't realize it. Because according to the scriptures, you cannot serve how many? Two masters. If you're serving one, then you cannot serve the other. Therefore, you can see that there's a great battle. There's a what? There's a great battle that's going on. Many, many a sincere people who long to follow God are caught up sometimes from childhood. The parents got them involved into it. Or their friends, like my friend, got me involved in smoking. And from smoking, I went to marijuana. From marijuana, I went to LSD and all sorts of stuff that I wish I had never touched. And so one thing leads to another. And so I wish that I had never had that friend come by me and showed me or try to tempt me with this particular, I bet you can't do this. You understand? And so once you get deceived to think that it's okay, then you're in trouble, because you'll never want to put all the effort you can into it as long as you try to justify it somehow. You must admit, recognize who is leading you by that addiction, and decide that you do not want to continue to be a slave anymore. And the only one who can give you the victory is Christ. Who is it? It is Christ. And so, that man wept when he realized the reality that he loved a cigarette. And he finally admitted it. He said, you're right, Pastor. I do love to smoke. And I said, if you're honest with God, and you say, God, I've learned to love this thing that's killing me, and I need your help. And if you turn to God honestly and admit that you need his help, then God can help you. See? There are thoughts and feelings suggested and aroused by who? By Satan, that annoy even the best men. But if they are not cherished, what's the condition? If they are not cherished, if they are what? Repulsed as what? Hateful. The soul is not what? Contaminated with guilt. And no other is defiled by their influence. See? So do you have sometimes thoughts that come to your mind that you wonder how those thoughts got there? That you didn't want to think those thoughts. You have no longer a desire for those things. And yet sometimes you're walking down the street and there they are. Okay? Does that happen to you at times? It says it happens even to the best man. To who? To the best man. Why? Satan is constantly seeking to manipulate the mind. To what? Manipulate your mind. And the only safety is for you to recognize that that happens and then realize that you need something to combat those thoughts. And those things that combat those thoughts are the things that Jesus used to overcome the enemy. Jesus constantly said to the devil, "It is written." It is what? It is written. In Christ, there's victory over even the thoughts. But you must recognize that there is a battle. So what is our hope? Our hope is to recognize our wretchedness. The scripture says that not one of us is good of our own selves. Paul said, "Oh, wretched man that I am, who shall what? Who shall deliver me from the body of this death?" Paul did not mix words. He did not try to justify. He did not try to cover up. He simply just admitted, recognized that he needed divine help. Do you see that? And when he recognized that, he also recognized that there was somebody, there was one who was able to deliver him from the body of this death, that is Christ. And so, when a person is tempted or a person is deceived, it is only through the Word of God that his mind can become clear to what is truth. And it is only through the Word of God that there is the power to enable the mind to change. When the mind changes, then the scripture says that a person will confess. Will what? Confess. And there must be faith in God that God can do precisely what he says. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us from our sins and what else? And cleanse us from how much? All unrighteousness. If any man be in Christ, he is a what? He is a new creation. All the things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. There is a battle. It takes place every day. It's played out in the lives of people. Whether or not they know it or not, the students that walk throughout this campus, whether or not they realize it or not, if they're not for God, they're for the other side. They may not intentionally want to be for the wrong side, or they may think that there's no such thing as a wrong and a right side. They just are living, quote, good lives. But the reality is, friends, that the battle is intensifying. The enemy is doing everything possible to collect as many as he can so that they can be lost. At the same time, the Spirit of God is working on human hearts and appealing to them to turn to him. Oh, my son, my daughter, give me your heart, what the Lord says. Do what? Give me your heart. And when Christ is speaking to Nicodemus, Jesus said to Nicodemus, "Except a man be what? Born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." There must be a change in the desires. There must be a change in the direction of the heart. There must be a change in the motives. There must be a change in the thinking. I was in Romania a couple of weeks ago, and one day, a gypsy came in. In Romania, there are many gypsies. The men have mustaches, they wear black hats and black clothing. The women dressed up with very, very colorful dresses and a headscarf. And so you can see the gypsies all over Romania, especially up in the north part of Romania, there are many, many gypsies. And I was holding a meeting like this, and there were about 450 people in the audience, and many of them were gypsies. And one day, a gypsy came up to me, and seemed like I recognized him. And sure enough, it was the one I thought I've seen before. And he came, and he grabbed me and hugged me and cried. And sure enough, it was Gabor was his name. And he said, "Do you remember me?" I said, "Yes, I remember you very well." And then he did this, and I said, "You don't have to do that. I remember you very well." Because I was preaching in Romania in 1991, and there were 4,500 people in the audience. And among them, there were many gypsies. Now, the gypsies over there, unfortunately, have the reputation that they steal. They what? They steal, they get drunk, and they fight with knives. Most of the gypsies carry a long knife in their pocket, okay? And I'm not talking about a little knife, I'm talking about a long knife. And they have these knife fights. Well, this particular night, after I finished the meeting, I was going to the dressing room, and this young gypsy man, he was 18 years old at the time, he came up to me, and he brought a friend with him, and said to me, "Do for him what you did for me." And I was bewildered. I didn't know who he was. I hadn't seen him before. Of course, if you have 800 gypsies in the audience, you don't know which one is which, you understand? So he said, "Do for him what you did for me." I said, I'm sorry, I don't know what you're talking about. I haven't done anything for you. He said, "Yes, you have." And I said, "What have I done for you?" And so then he rolled back the sleeves, and he had all sorts of knife scars, both arms full of scars, from all the fights he had been into. And he said, "Before I came to these meetings, that's what I used to do. I'd get drunk, me and my buddy, and we go out into the streets and get into these knife fights, and that's where I have all these scars." But he said, "As I've been attending and listening to the Word of God, something strange happened to me. One night, I felt something take place inside my heart. The desires for alcohol and for fighting somehow disappeared. And I began to feel strangely different." And he said, "I knew that something had happened. And I realized that what had happened is what you were talking about. You talked about being born again. I didn't know what that meant until I experienced it." He said, "So please do for my friend what you did for me." You see, what did he want for his friend? He wanted his friend to experience what he had experienced. He had been delivered. He had been what? He had been delivered from the power of who? Of the enemy. He had had a born-again experience. So I said to the young man that was with him, and the young man that was with him could barely stand. His eyes were bloodshot. His hair was all messed up, and he was just weaving back and forth like a boat. You understand what I'm saying? And I looked at him and I said, "Young man, do you want to be delivered?" "Yes," he said. I said, "How badly do you want to be delivered?" I'm willing to do anything," he said. I said, "Anything?" He said, "Yes, anything." I said, "Even to admit that you need God's help?" He said, "Yes." I said, "Are you willing to kneel down?" He said, "Yes, I'll kneel down." And he began to try to kneel down, and they had to help him get down because he couldn't get down by himself. And we knelt down. And I said, "Pour your heart out to God. Tell God what you need." And he began to pray. And he wept as he prayed. "Oh, God, help me. God, deliver me. God, take these things from me. God, change me." Do you think God was hearing those prayers? That young man wept and prayed. Then I blended my tears with him. And I said, "Lord, this young man has come because he wants a change of heart. Answer the prayer for this young man and change him." Then we stood up. I embraced him and I said, "Go back to your home and never turn back to the bottle again." He said, "Yes." Well, he left. And when it came time to baptize people, we baptized about 350 one particular day. There, those boys were with their wives. Their wives both came to me and kissed me and thanked me. And I said, don't thank me. I didn't do it. It was God who did it. They said, yes, but God used you. I said, praise God that he used me. And we decided, they said, we are so overjoyed that our husbands are no longer fighting and getting drunk and doing all those wicked things. They become good men. And I said, praise God for that. And those young men with their wives were baptized as a symbol demonstrating that something had happened to their hearts and that they had a new experience with Christ. If any man be in Christ, he is a what? He is a new creation. All things pass what? Away. And behold, all things, A-L-L, become new. Our friend, listen. There is a battle for the mind. But you do not have to let the enemy win the battle in your own heart. You can decide to have Jesus win the battle in your mind, in your heart. But you must decide to give your heart and mind to him. He will not come and force to take it. You must decide. Who must? You must decide. You must pour out your heart to him. You must ask him, Lord, change me. Take these things away from me. Give me the power to overcome. Make me different. And so, there is a selection that you must do. Let me just go to that picture so you can see. Here it is. There are two sides. There are what? There are two sides. You can choose the one, or you can choose the other. Tonight, which side will you choose? Will you choose the side of Christ tonight? How many of you would stand to that tonight and say, yes, I want to testify tonight that I want Christ to be the one who leads my life. And I want him to give me the power to change, to become all that he wants me to be. Are you willing to stand for that tonight? If you are, would you stand just now? Would you say yes to the Lord? Lord God, I want you to be the Lord of my life. I want you to change me. I want you to guide me. And I want you to seal me. To what? To seal me. I want to be yours forever. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, how grateful we are for the knowledge and understanding you give us. We know there's a battle because we fight it all the time. And sometimes we wonder if we'll ever overcome. Will we ever change? But you have already said that if we come to you, you will not turn us away. And that you will make a way of escape. So, Lord, we cast our hearts and minds in your favor. Forgive us when we have allowed ourselves to serve something else other than you. But we want you to be the Lord and master of our lives. We stand to that in testimony tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. Please be seated.